Okay, we're now gonna look at the allowance method using a percentage of accounts receivable. In a previous video, we looked at the percentage of sales method, and now we look at the percentage of accounts receivable method. And I wanna kind of compare the two. So it's probably best if you watch the two videos back to back. Okay, the accounts receivable method focuses on the balance sheet. We're trying to measure what is the net realizable value of accounts receivable, which is your total AR minus the allowance for bad debt equals net accounts receivable. Net accounts receivable is what you actually think you're gonna collect. So with the percentage of accounts receivable method, sometimes called an analysis of receivables, we're trying to measure the accounts receivable balance on the balance sheet, and we're not focusing on bad debt expense, which is on the income statement. The sales method focuses more on the income statement. The AR method focuses more on the balance sheet. Now, we have two separate examples, and just like with the sales method, we're going to assume that in example three, the allowance method has a $1,000 credit balance, which is this remaining leftover balance before this year's adjustment is made. And in example four, we're going to assume it has a debit balance. A credit balance, this leftover balance, simply means that last year we slightly overestimated bad debt. And if we have a debit balance, it means we slightly underestimated bad debt. We assume that this $1,000 balance is immaterial or insignificant. If it's a large number, it means we have to refine our percentages of uncollectible. Okay, so now what we do is we take total accounts receivable as of December 31st, the end of this time period, and it's 600,000. We multiply 600,000 times the uncollectible percentage. And by the way, this percentage came from an analysis of the accounts receivable aging report, which is a report that shows total accounts receivable, and then it breaks it down by whether or not they're currently current, if they're 1 month past due, 2 months, 3 months past due, etc. Most textbooks will have an example of an aging report in it. So we multiply 600,000, which is AR at the end of the year, times 10%, and this equals $60,000. Now here's the difference between the two methods. When we multiply total AR times the uncollectible percentage, what that number is what we believe the ending balance in the allowance should reflect, $60,000 of uncollectible receivables. Now, if I have a credit balance, or the remaining balance of $1,000 before adjustment, I'm gonna put X here, my adjusting journal entry will be the number that gets me from 1,000 credit to a 60,000 credit. In this case, it's $59,000. So my adjusting entry is I debit bad debt expense, again, which goes on the income statement, and I credit the allowance for bad debt. Okay, so if I have a credit balance of 1,000, and my analysis of receivables says I should have 60,000 in the allowance at year end, then to get from 1,000 credit to a 60,000 credit, I need to add $59,000. That's my adjusting entry. Debit bad debt expense, 59,000. Credit the allowance for bad debt, 59,000. In example four, my leftover balance before this year's adjustment is $1,000. I multiply accounts receivable of 600 times 10%, and again, that's 60,000. That's how much I believe the allowance for bad debt should have in it at the end of this year. So my adjusting entry, I'm gonna put X here, will be the amount that will get me from a $1,000 debit balance to a 60,000 credit balance. In this case, it's $61,000. And that's my adjusting entry. Debit bad debt expense, credit the allowance for bad debt for 61,000. Think of it this way. If I wanted a zero balance in the allowance, I would have to credit it for 1,000. That gets me to zero. If I want a 60,000 balance, I have to add then another 60,000 credit. So I have to credit the allowance for 61,000 if I have a debit balance. Compare the two, and hopefully that makes a little bit of sense to you. Okay, so again, what we're doing is, with this method, we're focusing on what should the allowance for doubtful accounts have as its ending balance? And how do we get there? We're not focusing so much on what bad debt expense should be. That's why bad debt expense is different if we have a credit balance versus a debit balance, because again, we're focusing on the balance sheet. Whereas with the sales method, the focus is more on the income statement. And remember, bad debt expense goes on the income statement. How much should bad debt expense be? Well, we want it to be 2% of sales, or $60,000, and that's what it is in both cases. And since this allowance had a $1,000 credit balance, the ending balance ends up being $61,000. Since we had a debit balance here, it ends up being $59,000, because we're not focusing on the balance sheet or the allowance, we're focusing on the income statement and bad debt expense. They're both acceptable methods, but it's useful to take a moment to kind of compare the two methods and try to identify the difference, okay? Most people get tripped up on the AR method because they'll multiply AR times the percentage and they'll think that's the adjusting entry, when it's not. That's what the ending balance and the allowance should be. The adjusting entry is how we get from the currently existing credit or debit balance to that $60,000 credit balance.